morning comes from the book of Amos, the fifth chapter, verses 6 through 7 and 10 through 15. Seek the Lord and live, or he will sweep through the house of Joseph like a fire. It will devour, and death will have no one to quench it. You who turn justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground, he who made the ladies in Orion, who turns blackness into dawn and darkness into night, who calls for the waters of the sea. You who hate the one who appears in court and despise him who tells the truth, you who trample on the poor and force him to give you grain. Therefore, though you have built stone mansions, you will not live in them. Though you have planted lush vineyards, you will not drink their wine. For I know how many offensive and how great are your sins. You oppress the righteous and take bribes. You deprive the poor of justice in the courts. Therefore, the prudent man keeps quiet in such times, for the times are evil. Seek good, not evil, that you may live. Then the Lord God Almighty will be with you just as he says he is. Hate evil and love good. Maintain justice in the courts. Perhaps the Lord God Almighty will have mercy on the remnant of Joseph. Then from the book of Hebrews, the fourth chapter, verses 12 through 16. For the word of the Lord is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, and joints and marrow. It judges thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes to him whom we must give account. There, since we have a great high priest who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. In our gospel lesson, which is our scripture passage today, comes from the 10th chapter of Mark, verses 17 through 31. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up before him and fell on his knees. Good teacher, he asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Why do you call me good? Jesus answered. No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not give false testimony. Do not defraud. Honor your father and your mother. Teacher, he declared, all these I have kept since I was a boy. Jesus looked at him and loved him. One thing you lack, he said. Go, sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said to them, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, who then can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, with man it is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God. Peter said to him, we have left everything to follow you. I tell you the truth, Jesus replied. No one who has left home, or brothers, or sisters, or mother, or father, or children, or fields, for me and the gospel, will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, and with them, persecutions. And in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last. May God have his blessing to the reading and hearing all of a sudden, here comes this man running up to him. In the ancient Middle East, it was considered undignified to run, particularly if you were a man of means. And not only did this man run up to Jesus, he knelt before him. He understood that there was something missing in his life. That was the assurance of eternal life. As a man of great means, he lacked very little in his life. There wasn't many things that he did without. But this eternal life, he didn't understand. He didn't believe that he had it. And it was something that he wanted greatly. He didn't understand that eternal life is a gift from God. Not something you buy. It's not something you purchase. It's not something you earn. God gives it freely. This man was not used to not being able to purchase the things that he truly wanted. But obviously he had heard Jesus speak about eternal life. And it was a concept that he cared enough to want to know about. I hope each of us care enough want to know about. That we want to know that when our life is over in this world, where we're going to go, what our faith will be once we take that last breath. This man had a great deal of wealth. Now let me address that briefly. There is no sin in being wealthy. The Bible speaks of several wealthy people who were very highly thought of in the Bible. Just a few are Abraham, Job, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, Philemon, along with several wealthy women who the Bible say basically funded Jesus' earthly ministry. Wealth is a gift from God. God has the right and the ability to give wealth. He has the right and the ability to take wealth away. And he has the right and ability to take you away from the wealth. To take you home if he so chooses. God blesses us with wealth so that his work and his kingdom and his purposes are glorified. God gives us wealth not to hold it, not to hoard it, but to use it to sustain ourselves and to build his kingdom. That's the reason God blesses us. We look at all the suffering and all the poverty in the world. It's not that God is lacking. It's not that God has not supplied enough. It's a matter of we haven't taken it on to fulfill God's purpose in this world. It doesn't mean you don't do your part. It just means that in this world today, we're not fulfilling what God's given us to do. God blesses us so that his kingdom is glorified. If you ask most people what wealthy is, they're going to say, well, it's a person who has a lot. To most people, though, the person who's wealthy has a little bit more than I do. That's most of our thoughts. They've got more than we are, probably both. Jesus was not opposed to this rich man. Jesus wanted to teach this rich man that the riches are not to be holding you. You're supposed to be holding the riches. If they hold you, then they're out of place. Next, we see that this rich man tried to flatter Jesus. He called him a good teacher. Jesus didn't rebuke him for calling him good. But he did tell him, he said, there is none good but God. The man was right. Jesus was good. Jesus was God. And Jesus wanted this man to get beyond flattery and understand that he is the Lord. This man was seeking eternal life, and he called him good because he wanted to warm up to him. He wanted to understand how he could have this by getting his attention and trying to win him over. If he truly understood what Jesus meant about eternal life, he would understand that Jesus had been trying to give him eternal life all along. It's Jesus' desire that he have eternal life, and that he spend the world in heaven with him and his Father. Man didn't understand that this is a free gift. Grace abounds freely. This man was looking for a price tag. He wanted to know what it was going to cost him. He didn't understand that the only way to God is through Jesus. And Jesus wants you to come freely. He wants to give it to you. This man measured and thought he was good enough. You know, most of us, if we're honest, measure as well. We're probably as good as our neighbors. We look around church and I'm probably doing as well as most of the folks in Oak Grove. We say, you know, I'm as good as most of them are. The measurement that Jesus uses is not how good our neighbors are. Not how good the people we get in church are. The measurement is the righteousness of God. And in that, we all fall short. We all need God's grace. We all need the blood that was shed on Calvary to buy our way into heaven, to redeem us, to love us. We can't buy it. We can't earn it. We can't distribute it. It's a gift from God, and a gift from God alone. Jesus talked to this man about five of the last six of the Ten Commandments. And he wanted to show him the standard that God had placed in front of him. And the young man didn't understand what Jesus was talking about. If he did, he knew that he was already broken the first commandment because he tried to elevate his riches and his position to a God-like standard. He'd gone through life thinking, hey, you know, I've got it all. I must be doing well. God must be proud of me. When in fact, he had separated himself from God because of his love of his money. Our actions can't save us. Our riches can't save us. Only the grace of our Lord can save us. This rich young man claimed that he had kept these commandments since he was a young boy. He was thinking, you know, if I've done these, I haven't committed adultery, I haven't murdered anyone, I haven't done anything that would dishonor my parents. I haven't told lies. Jesus didn't argue and try to prove the man wrong. He didn't try to humiliate him. He just wanted to show him how far he was from eternal life. Jesus wanted the man to have that eternal life. So he called him to show him the truth. He said, you lack one thing. Go give all you have to the poor. Come and follow me. And you'll have eternal life. And then you'll have great riches in heaven. Jesus wanted him to decide what he was going to trust in. Whether it was going to be his riches or whether it was going to be God. See, it wasn't just about the money. In that day, that man was talking about putting himself in another social class. He not only had money, because he had money, he had power. People came to him. They looked at him differently. Jesus was telling him to give that up. Come and follow me. Be about the kingdom of God, not about your riches. And it was too hard for them. It would be easy to point a finger at this rich young man. And you can say, well, you see what money causes? You see what it happens when you follow money? Before we're too hard on it, let's ask ourselves, what happens if Jesus says, go and sell everything you've got today and give the money to the poor? You can give it to the church. You can give it to a good social cause. You can take everything you've got and just give it to whatever charity you want to or whatever church you want to. And you say, but wait a second. I'm not rich. What if he says it doesn't matter? What you have is enough. Go give away and come and follow. Ouch. Ouch. You feel like that rich. You see, it's not the amount or even the money or the wealth itself. It's the attitude that we have towards God. Does what you have belong to you? Or does it belong to God? Do you believe the Bible when it says that everything is God's? And that God is sufficient to supply each of your needs? Or do you entrust your money? I believe in God. I've got this CD over here, and it's for a rainy day, and something bad happens. I go turn to this CD. When in fact, if you turn to God, you have far more security, far more lasting. There's a limit that the insurance will be on the bank. There is no limit to God. God is beyond that. He knows the number of hairs among your head. He knows what you need. He knows what you're going to face even before you face it. And He is sufficient. You don't get up in the morning without God knowing what He's going to do for you that day. The peace that He's going to bring to your life. The trouble that He's going to take. The problems He's going to keep from you. God does great things. This man went away. He was sad. And Jesus was sad too. Because Jesus loved him. He loves us. He wants from us the same thing. That we seek first the kingdom of God. It pained him to see this man go away. But how many people do you know that spend their life trying to be rich? Nothing wrong with working hard. Scripture calls us to do that as Christians. The disciples weren't sure about what Jesus was talking about, so he repeated it. And when he repeated it, he said, you know, it's easier to load up a camel and put that camel through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to give up his riches and go to heaven. He said, it's hard for man. But all things are possible with God. We open our hearts to God, He'll show us the way. You can have your money and have God too. But God has to be first. He has to be most important. He has to be in charge. How many people do we know this day that try to have all? We see the businessman who works hard, he goes to work early, he comes home late. Only time he sees his family are the 2 weeks of the glorious vacation. And then back to work again, and the kids go to a great college, and then they leave and take a job on the other side of the world. And they never see him very often again. Once in a while on Christmas, once in a while on vacation. How many times do we see the woman who is afraid she missed something? So when that guy turns his head and looks at her twice, she starts having bad thoughts and she starts making mistakes. And the next thing you know, good marriage is gone down the drain because she was afraid she was missing something. How many times do we see children worry about being popular to the point that they turn to alcohol and drugs because they won't fit in? And they ruin a good life. When God sets them apart and wants to use them as an example and has a better plan for them. Jesus invites us to come to Him and trust Him and to find our peace with Him. The disciples were having a very hard time in this example. Peter asked the Lord, he said, Lord, what about us? He said, we've given up everything for you. What about us, Lord? And Jesus answered him, he said, no one has given up houses or brothers or sisters or fathers or mothers, wives or children, or land for my sake and the sake of the gospel, who will not receive it back 100-fold in this life and in the next eternal. But mind you, there's a word in here that he said that most people miss when they read this verse. And that is with persecutions. We're not promised that life's going to be easy. We're not promised that life is going to be just as simple as it can be and we're going to have everything we ever asked for. situation that money wouldn't buy you out of before you leave this world, you probably will. And you'll need to hit your knees. And you'll need to know the God that you're praying to. And you need to know that He is secure. And that He is faithful for what you ask of Him. And that He will deliver that. This rich young ruler walked away sad because he wanted something that money couldn't buy. He claimed to lead a good life, and Jesus didn't argue with him, but when he put him to the test, his riches were more important than the eternal life he saw. He thought his riches was more secure than the Lord. I hope we don't make that mistake. Many people go through life and they wonder why trials come. If you're at a point in life where everything's good, everything's rosy and working out, I'm glad for you. But I need to let you know, it's not going to last forever. Things change. If you're at the bad part of your life and you wonder if anything's ever going to work out again, let me give you a hope. It's going to change. Things will get better. It's called life. And we all go through it. And we all need the Lord. We're not going to take anything from this world. Nothing goes with us when we leave. We leave it all behind. And when the day comes that we're near the end of this world, what's going to be important is our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and with our family and with the things that the Lord has given us to hold us in the world. That's what's going to matter. Our Lord calls each of us to eternal life. And we live with the assurance, if you're a Christian, that there's a better life waiting for you beyond this world. If we allow our faith to grow, we will not long for the things of this world, but we'll long for the greater things. Because there's a better world. The Bible talks about the place where there's streets of gold. The best we have here is asphalt or concrete. Heaven has gold. God desires for us to have a better life. He desires for us to have eternal life and to enjoy this life here on this earth, looking forward to the day that we will be with Him. I close with a story about a couple who had a young daughter. Her name was Jean. One day they're in a department store and Jean sees this little cardboard box with costume pearls. And Jeannie thinks those are just the most beautiful things that she has ever seen. And her parents buy them for her. And Jeannie is hardly ever seen without those pearls around her neck. Little Jeannie loves those pearls. She just wears them all the time. It's a battle to get them off of. They don't let her get in the pool and take a bath with them because they know that those costume pearls will turn her neck green. And they don't want that for Jeannie. So that's the only two times. And she's hardly dry before the pearls have to go back around her neck. One day, her parents are talking, and they said, you know, the way Jeannie loves those pearls, let's buy her some real pearls. And her father says, yeah, that's a great idea. Let's do that. And I want to get a chance to teach her a lesson while we do that as well. So one day, as he comes home from work, he's got a bag, and in that bag is a box of real pearls. And he sits in his chair, and Jeannie comes up and he hugs him, and he says, Jeannie, do you love me? Daddy, you know I love you. Jeannie, I want you to trust me. Will you trust me, Jeannie? Daddy, you know I'll trust you. I love you too. Jeannie, I want your pearls. Give me your pearls. Are you going to give them back, Daddy? No, I'm not. I want you to give me your pearls. Daddy, not my pearls. I love them, Daddy, please, not my pearls. And tears start coming in her eyes. And Daddy looks down and says, Jeannie, it's okay, honey, I love you. You're my little daughter, I'll always love you. You'll always be precious to me. You go play, don't worry about those pearls. A little later, Jeannie comes back and she's got a princess. Daddy, please, take my princess. I love this princess. This princess is special. Take my princess dead, Jenny. I ask you for the pearls. May I have the pearls? No, Daddy. And she walks away. The next evening, her dad comes by, and he's sitting in his chair. Here comes Jenny with her little lip quivering and the pearls in her hand. Daddy, I love you more than I love these pearls. Take these pearls. And he does. And he replaces them with real jewelry, real value. And that's what God wants to do for us, is to take the things that we cling to, the things that we can't live without, we think. And he wants to replace them with things of real love, things of real meaning, and real purpose. Are we clinging to things that we're going to leave behind? Things that really don't matter. Jesus has better. He has more. He wants to give it to us. We trust him. Let us pray. Precious Lord, your word tells us that you love us as a father loves his children. Lord, you love us beyond that, but there's not a better example that you can give us than that love, which means that you spared nothing, not even your own son, for us. Lord, you want good for us, better than we even ask for ourselves. And yet sometimes, Lord, we don't see it. Open our eyes, Lord. Show us what is real. Show us what is eternal. And give us that eternal vision that we may follow it and we may trust it. And we may seek it for ourselves and for our family and for those that we love. And fill our heart, Lord, with a longing for you and the good things that you bring. Father, we love you. We trust you. May we not hold back the pearls that are meaningless for the real gift that you have from us and for us. This we pray.